Now we will study about the roof of the fourth ventricle. First of all, about the structure of the roof. You can see, now imagine actually the cerebellum has been removed and this floor of the fourth ventricle, the cavity of the fourth ventricle, you are not seeing, remember, because it is being covered by the roof. Look here. Cerebellum, we say, is forming the roof, is not the correct thing. Cerebellum is actually in dorsal relation of the fourth ventricle. It, of course, covers the fourth ventricle from the dorsal side. But the roof is formed by this, you know, thinned out sheet of nervous tissue. And this thinned out sheet is called superior and inferior medullary vellum. So make sure that actually, जिस तरह से हम बोलते हैं कि the roof is formed by the cerebellum is actually not the correct way, because roof that is like the, said to be in the it, the fourth ventricle is covered on the dorsal side and it's related posterior to the cerebellum, but you know actually the fourth ventricle, you know, ventricle is a closed cavity. The intraventricular system is a closed cavity in the CNS except at these three sites of where this communicates with the subarachnoid plexus in the fourth ventricle. These are the foramina. Otherwise, the complete thing. So that means this fourth ventricle has to be covered on the dorsal side as well. So on the dorsal side, the roof is formed by the thin layer of nervous tissue divided into two parts. This upper portion is called the superior medullary vellum and the lower portion is called the inferior medullary vellum. And superior medullary vellum, you must have been heard of this name before also while I was teaching the trochlear nerve, remember, at just below, you know, below the inferior colliculus of the midbrain dorsally, you find is the trochlear nerve that emerges, and the middle portion is called frenulum velli. From you know, this nerve actually decussates within this substance of medullary vellum. So this nerve decussates within the substance of superior medullary vellum and then it emerges on the opposite side, right? And here in between is the frenulum velli. So they have differently color coded it. This, the upper portion, the blue portion, is superior medullary vellum. And the lower portion, the green color coded here, is the inferior medullary vellum, right? And now look here. If you remember, I have taught you the cerebellum, and the cerebellum, the you know, the median band of fibers which communicate the two cerebral hemispheres, the two cerebral cerebellar hemispheres are joined with the help of this vermis, right? And you know that vermis on the dorsal side had like was divided into five parts, right? And that was, let's meet in CCD fast. And on the ventral aspect, posterior to anterior, was the pun. So lingula, now look here, it is cerebellum placed over to this. All this is being covered by cerebellum with its peduncles, superior, inferior and medial cerebellar peduncles. Now in between, you can imagine here that here it will be the vermis of the cerebellum with its two anterior ends. The anterior end of the upper, yani ki superior surface of the vermis, is formed by lingula, and the anterior end of the inferior portion of the vermis is formed by nodule. Remember the diagram of the cerebellar hemispheres which I had told you. Now when you know when the vermis is folded on its, the ventral and dorsal surfaces of the vermis are approximated, then lingula meets the nodule. This I told you in the beginning. I believe you are getting what I am trying to say. And it's a three-dimensional thing. You can imagine it like the vermis when folded, the ventral surface of the vermis the superior surface overlies the ventral surface or the inferior surface. Then the lingula overrides the nodule. So this is the anterior end of the vermis, right? So the important thing is that the superior medullary vellum is attached, or it covers the, you know, the vermis on its superior aspect, reaching up to the either side of lingula. Similarly, the inferior medullary vellum covers the inferior aspect of the vermis, and on either side, it is attached on either side of the nodule, right? Because, you know, it is a tent shaped. First of all, think about that the fourth ventricle, many times in my previous images, I have been showing you that the roof of the fourth ventricle is tent shaped, right? So to be in a tent shaped, this, you know, the apex of the tent should be, you should have something anchoring to it, while otherwise the tent would collapse. And it's a thin layer, you know, superior inferior medullary vellum, they are very thin layers. तो कोई भी टेंट लगता है, तुमने इतनी जगह टेंट लगे देखे, या तो उसमें पोल लगेगा बीच में एक सेंटर में जो उस टेंट को ऊपर उठा के रखेगा, राइट? और दी अदर वे इज हम टेंट के जो एपेक्स है उसको ऊपर ही बाइंड कर दें. सो यू कैन इमेजिन दैट दिस रूफ इज एक्चुअली टेंट शेप्ड एंड इट इज बाइंडेड हियर टू द एंटीरियर एंड ऑफ द वर्मिस. सो द सुपीरियर मेडुलरी वेलम इज बीइंग एलिवेटेड डॉर्सली, being attached here to the lingual on either sides. Similarly, inferior medullary vellum is held high up dorsally, being pulled up, because it's attached to the nodule on the two sides. I hope you got it now. So yes, that's sir. How it is elevated on the dorsal side. Then the difference in the superior and inferior medullary vellum is that this is a thin sheet, of course, on the inner surface. If you talk about the inner surface of this superior inferior medullary vellum, will be lined by ependymema, right? Because all the ventricles are lined by ependymema on the inner side. So similarly, these two superior inferior medullary vellum on the inner surface, they will be lined by ependymema. But on the dorsal surface here, the superior medullary vellum has a nervous tissue. Remember, a thin layer of nervous tissue overlies the superior medullary vellum. While the inferior medullary vellum on the undersurface will be, undersurface means facing toward the ventricle, will be having an ependymal layer. But it is devoid of nervous tissue. Got it? It is devoid of nervous tissue. And both these layers, because, you know, the entire CNS and outsides is intimately lined by pia mater, even the cerebellum also, and similarly here also. So wherever, you know, pia mater, as I told you, we remember the pleura. I told you that visceral pleura goes within the fissures of the lungs. Similarly, the pia mater reaches within the sulci of the cerebrum, sulci of the cerebellum, right? Even any space, any fissure which he finds, pia mater moves inside. So here also, the superior medullary, inferior medullary vellum, both of them on the dorsal aspect, they will be covered by pia mater as well. But the important thing here is that here you won't find a layer of nervous tissue. So this will be comparatively thinner than the superior medullary vellum. So what you'll find here in the inferior medullary vellum, that it's on the ventral side, it is only the ependymal layer. Then without any nervous tissue, it is covered by two layers of pia mater. That's important. So it is covered by, you know, doubly folded pia mater. So that is called tela choroidea, right? So without any nervous tissue in between the, in the lower half, the roof of the fourth ventricle is formed by inferior medullary vellum, and there it has, on the lower portion, it is only the ependymema on the ventral side covered by double fold of pia mater, and that is called tela choroidea. But remember, as I told you, it also has to be held high up to form a tent-shaped roof. So that's why here the inferior medullary vellum adjacent to the, it is attached adjacent to the nodule also. Then distillochroidea is thing is very clear now. Then because you know this portion here, the pont, it's a junction, pontomedullary junction on the ventral side. At the pontomedullary junction, there was this artery given off from the vertebral artery, and that was called posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Yaad aaya? And posterior inferior cerebellar artery was having a tortuous course, and it was the chief supply of the cerebellum on the inferior surface. And while in its course, it also perfuses the medulla and the pons on their lateral surface. Okay. So remember that the choroid plexus of the fourth ventricle is formed by the choroidal branches or choroidal fringes from the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. So those branches, the choroidal branches, they form this in T-shaped vascular fold, and that is called choroid plexus. T-shaped choroid plexus. This you find in the fourth ventricle in the lower half, and that is called tela choroidea. So you have seen that the vascular fringes from the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, they move in, and if you see, it's actually 2L, right L and left L. So this is the stem of the T, right? And this stem of the T, if you see closely, it will be two parallel vertical fringes of the choroid plexus or the arteries, right? That forms the choroid plexus. And these are the horizontal limbs of the T. Okay. So that was about the choroid plexus of the fourth ventricle. Now this ventricle is actually a closed chamber inside, which is lined by ependymoma from all the sides. This ventricle will continue down as a central canal of the closed portion of medulla as well as a spinal cord at the level of obex. But as I told you that this is the site from where the CSF will leak out into the subarachnoid space. So there are three apertures, three openings, or three point of leakage of CSF from the fourth ventricle. Here you're seeing is this in the dorsal median plane, little above to the obex. You find is a median aperture, and this median aperture is called foramen of Meggendi. M for median, M for Meggendi. And you can imagine all this is being covered by cerebellum. So here there will be an angle formed between the inferior aspect of the cerebellum and the dorsal aspect of the medulla, and that angle is called cerebellomedullary angle. And there will be a dilatation of a subarachnoid space, and that is called cerebellomedullary cistern or the cisterna magna. Here, this space here between cerebellum and medulla is called cisterna magna. So this foramen of Meggendi leaks the CSF from the central cavity out into the subarachnoid space in the cisterna magna. Then, as I told you that this was the upper part of the fourth, this is the lower portion of the fourth ventricle, and was an intermediate portion also. And that intermediate portion was exceeding beyond this rhomboid fossa in the form of lateral recesses on both the sides. And that was through the lateral apertures. And because L for lateral, you can remember that these two apertures on the two sides are called Luschka's foramen. L for lateral, L for Luschka's. Okay. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this Lushka, this foramen, your lateral recess, it is partly occupied by the choroid plexus, you can see, into the subarachnoid space. This means because of this, recess, that is a, space of the fourth ventricle extending out through the lateral recess, and through this choroid plexus also protrudes out into the subarachnoid space. That's through foramen of Lushka. Similarly, here, can you see now these choroid plexus? They're even protruding out through the foramen of Meibomian. So that means there is one thing, like CSF drains through these foramen out into the subarachnoid space, but also the choroid plexus is having protruding out through these three foramen into the subarachnoid space. Means what? Like there is some direct secretion of CSF from the subchoroid plexus into the subarachnoid space because of these protrusions, right? This is choroid plexus, this is choroid plexus, and this is the choroid plexus emerging out of this foramen of Meibomian. So that means if choroid plexus is protruding out of these foramen into the subarachnoid space, there is, you can say that some part of the CSF in the subarachnoid space is also being formed and drained, formed directly from the choroid plexus, leaking out into these foramen, passing out from these foramen. Okay, so there you find you've been, taught about these choroid plexus. So remember, because of these spaces, this branch, the vascular fringes on the posterior in inferior cerebellar artery, they enter inside here over to the tiloid, tilacoroidea on the lower half of the dorsum of the fourth ventricle, and they form the choroid plexus. I hope it is clear and understood now. And this portion of the inferior medullary vellum on the two sides, it is attached to the nodule, and similarly superior medullary vellum is attached to lingula. Together it is pulled up in the form of a ten-shaped fold. Okay, so that was about the roof. Now this is a sagittal section where you can see the openings, as this, is the brain stem, the midbrain, pons, and then medulla. Here you find is the pontine cisterna pontis. This is the cisterna pontis. And this area between the dorsal upper portion of the medulla and the ventro-inferior portion of the cerebellum, this angle is cerebellomedullary angle, and the space, the dilatation here is called cisterna magna or cerebellomedullary cistern, right? So the dilatations of the subarachnoid space are named accordingly. Okay, and here you're seeing that this is the fourth ventricle, lower half of the pons, upper half of the medulla, and superiorly it is continuous as cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius, which is the cavity of the mesencephalon, and it continues above to the third ventricle. And this is the point which is called obex. Remember, where the two, tinea meet, forming the inferior angle of this fourth ventricle, there it continues as the central canal. The central canal is not only in the spinal cord, but also in the closed portion of the medulla also. Then the communications openings, as I told you here, you can see this is the roof of the fourth ventricle, and as I was telling, this is the superior medullary. Is the slide visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is what is superior medullary vellum, and this is inferior medullary vellum. And here you're seeing that in this inferior medullary vellum, down below there is an aperture that is called foramen of Meibomian. And on the lateral, on the two sides, because this fourth ventricle has lateral recesses on the two sides where they have foramen, this is called foramen of Lushka, placed laterally. from where the the horizontal limbs of the T-shaped choroid plexus protrudes out. And this is the fold of blood vessels inside forming the choroid plexus. This is the choroid plexus, the fourth ventricle formed by, remember, posterior inferior cerebellar artery. ये बहुत पूछा जाता है क्योंकि अभी और भी सारे वेंट्रिकल्स हैं, लिटल वेंट्रिकल्स हैं, उसके कई पार्ट्स हैं, एंटीरियर हॉर्न, इंफीरियर हॉर्न, लिटल हॉर्न, सिमिलरली थर्ड वेंट्रिकल है, देन व्हेन यू विल गेट अ कलेक्शन ऑफ दीज वेंट्रिकल्स, देन इट विल बिकम कंफ्यूजिंग. सो कीप रिमेंबरिंग फ्रॉम राइट नाउ द कोरॉइड प्लेक्सस ऑफ डिफरेंट वेंट्रिकल्स आर बींग फॉर्म्ड बाय डिफरेंट आर्टरीज. सो राइट नाउ यू गॉट ओनली वन टू रिमेंबर and that is the posterior inferior cerebellar artery forming the choroid plexus of fourth ventricle. And what else can you see? Yes, the 10-shaped thing. Can you see here the 10-shaped thing? This 10-shaped here is because of the vormis here. In between the two cerebral hemispheres, there is vormis, and it is this lingula and nodule below, onto which the superior medullary vellum and inferior medullary vellum is attached, and because of that, that is elevated, and that elevation here, again, it's a recess which is going deep inside into the white matter of the cerebellum, and this is called median dorsal recess. Median dorsal, and there were two lateral recesses I already told you. Okay. So now you are seeing, is the slide visible?
Yes, sir.